Hello friends, good evening. So this will be the 51st COVID-19 update. So 50th I haven't done. So the 50th I will be doing another topic. So I've just started doing on another topic. So I'll do it in the 50th. So this is mucormycosis. So I'm sure my friends, so this has become a very topical subject now with many cases being reported across the nation. So the first case was reported from Surat. After that, the number of cases has been increasing across our nation, and we have started seeing in our state as well. So only yesterday we had one case within our hospital with mucormycosis. So it is very prudent that we discuss about this particular topic and have a good clarity. So this 15th May 2021. So I'll be recording this talk on Saturday. So when you talk about mucormycosis, so this is the structure, the way the mucormycosis looks. It is a hyphae, it's a fungus. So basically it has these spores. As you see, they have these spores and the infection spreads through the spores. So any individual who gets infected, generally the infection tends to happen by inhalation of these spores. Sometimes these spores can enter the body through any of the open wounds that we may have in any wartime situation. So I'll talk about it later. But in the current situation, the predominant way of spread is through inhalation of the spores from this mucor. So just very briefly about how this fungus behaves. So basically this fungus has something called ketone reductase, and this helps in it to thrive in a condition where there is a lot of glucose in the body. So in any diabetic patient where there is hyperglycemia, along with it, if there is an acidic medium, this is the situation in which this fungus tends to thrive, and because of the presence of this ketone reductase in it. So the important risk factor is diabetic and someone who is acidemic. I think these two are typically a combination which we see in someone who is getting sick due to COVID. So whatever this narrative we are giving is more in the context of COVID. So the filaments of this fungi is around 5 to 15 micron in diameter. So in comparison, these filaments are much larger than Aspergillus, because in Aspergillus, the filaments are found to be much smaller, around 2 to 8 microns. And these filaments are very irregular and they are not regular. And another distinct feature of this fungi is they do not have septations. So Aspergillus or other filamentous fungi tend to have septations. And when septations are there, the fungi tends to be a lot more stable and it is easier to grow in the culture medium. So if there are no septations, these become very fragile. And it is claimed that it is very difficult to grow these fungi in the culture medium. And another important aspect of this mucor species or the filamentous fungi is they are very angio-invasive. So they like the blood vessels and they tend to spread through the blood vessels, and they block the blood vessels, and there'll be a lot of infarctions in the tissues when the mucormycosis becomes very disseminated. So it is angio-invasive and causes a lot of infarctions in the tissues in which it spreads. And so let us briefly understand, so what are the types of these mucors that are that are reported? So the common one are the mucor, and the other one is the rhizopus. So these are very common. And Cunninghamella also is claimed to be common. And this is the more dreaded mucor, Cunninghamella. So it has a lot more virulence and a lot more severity. And the other one is Saxena. So it's easy to remember, Saxena. And apophysomycosis is a little rarer variant. So the more commoner ones are the first three, mucor, rhizopus, and Cunninghamella. And Saxena also is seen. Apophysomycosis is found to be little rare. So this is about little bit about speciation of these mucor. So another distinct feature which the listeners should understand about this mucor is it likes iron. So whenever there is a lot of iron in the body, and this is something which one has to postulate, because although we understand ferritin is more of an inflammatory marker, so the presence of more iron or diferoxamine, so basically iron, this chelates the iron and aluminum. The diferoxamine which is present chelates iron and aluminum, and that increases the risk of mucor. So once the chelation happens, there is a chelated complex that is formed, which is called ferroxamine. And this presence of this ferroxamine increases the iron uptake by the mucor, and mucor tends to thrive and tends to spread in the presence of increased iron in the body. So any individual who has more iron or there is deferoxamine, so that facilitates creation of this ferroxamine, which leads to iron uptake by the mucor and helps it to thrive. So this is something which is very distinctly unique to this mucor. So let us come to the risk factors. So now, since this narrative is more in context to the COVID, the predominant risk factor for mucor in COVID would be obviously the extensive usage of steroids in COVID. And that definitely has put the patients at risk for developing this mucor. The commonest underlying risk factor, which otherwise we see in hematopoietic stem cell transplant or solid organ transplant patients. And predominantly, mucor has been reported in the literature pertaining to these solid organ or stem cell transplant in 17 to 50% of the individuals. Or any individual who is getting iron dextrose infusions or iron infusions, they are at a risk, diabetic getting iron infusions. So they pose a risk for developing mucor mycosis, and someone who is immunocompromised with AIDS. And another important feature is the war victims or any trauma situation where there is a blast injuries or a war situation or a polytrauma involving a lot of soft tissue damage. So mucor is present in the soil. It's a fungus which is present in the soil, and 18% of it has been reported from the trauma, from the patients who have undergone trauma. And malnourishment, malnourished individuals are at a risk because they are immunocompromised. So, but since we're talking about COVID, in COVID, there are two conditions which puts them at a risk for developing mucor. One is steroid and one is the diabetes. And as you see in all the reported literature, diabetes constitutes an important risk factor in 23 to 36%. So the most commonest would be the underlying malignancy. The second commonest would be the diabetics. And in COVID, it will be predominantly diabetics and steroid usage. And very interestingly, this is something which I found interesting. In US, it has been found that in diabetics who are on statins, the risk of mucor is found to be very low. And increasingly, the risk of mucor has been shown to consistently decrease because most of the diabetic patients in US have been put on statins. So this is some interesting correlation. So we need to look into the data if there is really supporting evidence that use of statins in any of these patients reduces the risk of them developing mucor. So that is something for just people to bear in mind. And this is another interesting thing, which also may be important in this COVID situation. There is something called healthcare associated mucor. And 47% of the patients who develop mucor within the hospital has been attributed to the dirty linen and the linen contaminated with mucor. So this is another interesting aspect in the COVID situation where linen has to be very extensively sanitized because there is a literature claim of 47% of mucor developing in the hospital comes from the contaminated linen. So this is very important. So again, infection control practices has to be emphasized to prevent the nosocomial spread of mucor. So this is a point to be highlighted in COVID. So in COVID, obviously use of steroid, diabetic, and good sanitization of the linen, because a dirty linen, which is not well sanitized, can help, can really spread the infection within the hospital. So this is something which is of importance to be kept in mind and noted. And there, as I said, the natural disasters also lead to mucor, because as I said, mucor is a fungus which is present in the soil. And the mucor mycosis breakouts have happened in a natural disaster like tornadoes, tsunami, and volcanoes. There's one report from US where this fungi has been reported. So it's Apophysomyces fungus breakout, which was reported in 13 patients, 10 of them needing ICU, and 5 of them died because of this Apophysomyces, which was reported from this tornado. So COVID associated is what is of relevance now. So mucor can present in two different phases. One is it can manifest along with COVID. Whilst patient is suffering from COVID and you're treating them with steroids, they can develop mucor. So that is one aspect. Or mucor can develop after they get better from the COVID, they get discharged, and then they can develop. So there is one case series which is reported from US, where mucor has developed 5 days after patient is discharged from hospital. It was predominantly the gastric mucor mycosis. So mucor can affect multiple areas in the body. The most commonest is rhinoorbital mucor mycosis. And the second commonest would be the pulmonary mucor mycosis. So gastric mucor mycosis also is not uncommon. Cutaneous mucor mycosis is one, and disseminated. So these are the distinct clinical presentations of mucor. So the most commonest one, which is a dreaded thing that our nation is facing with MUCOR, is rhinoorbital cerebral mucormycosis. Because we know once the sinuses are involved and the orbit is involved, it spreads to the brain very fast. And once it spreads to the brain, the mortality is going to be very, very high. So a rhinoorbital mucormycosis, so you would have patient with a black pigmentation on the inner canthus of the nasal septum and nasal and the eye. So 70% of them has been reported in patients with DKA. But in COVID, we are seeing predominantly diabetics, and even there are reports in non-diabetic patients. So they can present with headache, they can present with lot of cheekbone pains, and they can have nasal blocks and nasal discharges. And in the eye, they can have periorbital edema, they can have proptosis and diplopia and blindness. So these are some of the symptomology they can present with when they have mucormycosis. And very distinctly, when someone's nose is involved or sinuses is involved, it is very imperative that a clinician looks at the hard palate. So you would see a black pigmentation on the hard palate, which is a very striking hallmark sign of mucor. And when that happens, immediate sort of a surgical intervention has to be done in clearing the sinus, and multiple debridements have to be done to remove the filamentous fungi from the sinus and obviously prevent the spread to the brain, along with our antifungal agents, which we'll talk about. So this is one published report which has reported the percentages of all the symptomology in 208 patients. So fever was present as a common symptom in 44%. And this was followed by nasal ulceration and nasal necrosis in 38%. Periorbital swelling or the facial swelling was seen in 34%, and reduced vision was present in 30%. Ophthalmoplegia was present in 29%. Sinusitis was present in 26%, and headache was present in 25%. So the commonest symptom is still fever and the nasal ulceration and nasal stuffiness and nasal necrosis and nasal discharge. So nasal followed by the eye, periorbital swelling and the facial swelling. And these are followed by reduced vision and headaches. So once the headache starts, so one should worry that whether it is spreading into the brain. So these are some of the reported symptomology. So pulmonary mucor. So we spoke about rhinoorbital mucormycosis. Pulmonary mucormycosis is the second commonest one. So basically, the spread to the lung, which happens with the inhalation, can lead to pneumonia, and it can lead to infarction in the lungs. So there can be infarction in the lung, there can be pneumonia, and there's a lot of necrosis that happens in the lung, which can lead to hemoptysis of these patients. So this is the typical presentation. They can present with pneumonia, infarctions in the lung, and extensive necrosis of the lung leading to hemoptysis. So this is the typical presentation with pulmonary mucor. And most and 40 to 60%, when they have pulmonary mucormycosis, they seed into the blood and they can have disseminated mucormycosis. And once dissemination happens, the mortality is almost 100%. So then there is GI mucormycosis, where 58% of the time stomach is involved. So they can have a very necrotic ulcers in the stomach as part of GI mucormycosis. Esophagus is rarely involved. Colon is involved in 32%. Ileum and esophagus are rarely involved. And they can present with bowel infarctions and ischemic bowel. So necrotic ulcers in the stomach and ischemic bowels are the presentation of GI mucormycosis. And they can present with upper GI bleed. So cutaneous mucormycosis, this is how they look. They look like an indurated, very painful lesions, and they can get indurated and they can form a dark eschar like this. And cutaneous mucormycosis is little more benign version. So the most fulminant one would be obviously rhinoorbital, and pulmonary is more fulminant, and disseminated is more fulminant, followed by GI, and the cutaneous is less fulminant than these because it is easier to achieve source control in cutaneous. So the renal mucormycosis is also reported in transplant patients, and CNS and disseminated mucormycosis. As I said, the disseminated mucormycosis, where there is seeding of this mucor in the blood, mortality is reported to be 96%. Almost everyone would die once dissemination happens. As I said, once someone has a pulmonary mucormycosis, 40 to 50% of them will evolve to have disseminated mucormycosis. So they'll go on to developing disseminated mucormycosis, where the death would be almost 100%. So this is the typical clinical spectrum of mucormycosis. So how do we go about diagnosing? So as you would see, the diagnosis is very distinct clinically. So if someone presents with any black, that's why you would see in the news media report people talking about black fungus. So whenever someone presents with a black necrotic lesion in the nose or swelling of the eye in the post-COVID who has received steroids, who has underlying diabetes, always please look into the oral cavity. Any black pigmentation in the hard palate or soft palate should raise an index of suspicion that it is possibly mucor. Definitive diagnosis is to take, debride the tissue and send it for histopathological examination and identifying this filamentous fungi. As I said, because it does not have septations, it is said that it is very difficult to grow this in the culture medium. PCR techniques have been used and are found to be very good in identifying the mucor. But the easiest way is clinical and debriding the tissue and doing a histopathological examination. So they have tried MALDI, which is matrix-assisted laser desorption ionization time of flight test. So this is also is found to be effective. I think the simplest one, to keep it simple, histopathological examination and the clinical examination goes a long way in picking up this mucor. So coming to treatment, so the treatment is three-armed treatment. So first, the most important aspect, which we cannot emphasize more, is early debridement. So there's no point sitting on these patients and giving only antifungal. The emphasis, as soon as you suspect a mucor, it is very, very important for an intensivist or for any physician to involve ENT surgeons and ophthalmologists, and they have to work as a team. And there is no point waiting. These patients have to be immediately taken up for surgical debridement, extensive debridement of the tissues. It can be quite mutilating, but that is the way to save lives. So I can't emphasize more on role of surgical intervention and surgical debridement by ENT surgeons and ophthalmologists to clear all the necrotic tissue to prevent further spread, because this is rapidly, rapidly invasive, and time is the key thing. So debridement to remove all the filamentous fungi and preventing further spread is the way to achieve good source control. Along with it, we have to obviously use good antifungal agents, and we'll talk about it. And the third important dimensions which one should not forget is to treat the underlying immunosuppression that is happening, which means if someone is in a DKA, obviously you have to treat DKA and correct and maintain good glycemic levels and correct acidosis. And if someone is obviously on high dose steroids or immunosuppressants, as much as it is feasible, try to reduce steroids, or even if feasible, stop the steroids or stop any other immunosuppressants that patient may be receiving. And the antifungal agent of choice, which I'm sure every listener would know, is amphotericin B. So if you look at any society guidelines, the guideline recommendation is liposomal amphotericin B to protect the kidneys, because the mortality sequentially increases once the AKI sets in mucor mycosis. So we have to obviously protect the kidneys. So, and as friends, you all would be hearing already, we hear about shortage of this liposomal amphotericin B. If it is absolutely not available, obviously we have to resort to using amphotericin B. So the dosage of liposomal amphotericin is 5 mg/kg per day. But so there is a suggestion in patients with severe mucor, you can even go up to 10 mg/kg per day at a supranormal level to have good control over spreading of this mucor mycosis. So liposomal amphotericin B is the drug of choice recommended by all societies, 5 to 10 mg/kg. 5 mg is the recommended dose, but if it is a rapidly invasive mucor and you believe that clinically you are losing control, you can go up to 10 mg/kg per day is what is suggested. So there are these new antifungal agents which are effective against the mucor. So now the question is whether we combine amphotericin B with other agents which are effective against mucor. So the two other agents which are effective against mucor are posaconazole, which is a newer antifungal agent, and isavuconazole. But the combination is not recommended by any of the society guidelines. So the suggestion or recommendation is to stick to one antifungal, which is liposomal amphotericin. If patient is absolutely intolerant to amphotericin B because of whatever allergic reaction, then one could resort to IV posaconazole or IV isavuconazole. So amphotericin B, now the question is, how long would you continue amphotericin B? Amphotericin B has to be continued until clinical improvement. And this generally happens over several weeks, and even it may be months for complete clinical resolution to happen. And as I said, the treatment is not for 7 days, 10 days, or 2 weeks. It continues for a few weeks until you're absolutely sure that there is no spread of the fungus and you have control over the fungus. So once clinical stability is achieved, what one could do or what is suggested is it could be de-escalated. So these drugs, posaconazole and isavuconazole, the good thing about this is these two drugs are available as oral and IV, and posaconazole can be used, and both these drugs can be used as a step-down therapy, IV or oral. So posaconazole as a step-down therapy is given as tablets, 300 mg twice a day, followed by 300 mg once a day after 1 or 2 days. But the key aspect of posaconazole is the recommendation is to check the serum concentration, and it is desirable that the serum concentration is maintained at more than 1 micrograms per ml when you're using posaconazole. So when it comes to isavuconazole, it is available as capsules. So it is recently introduced into India by Pfizer. So the dosage is 200 mg 3 times a day for 2 days, followed by 200 mg once a day. So this is the dose that one would use after you have achieved good control over mucor with amphotericin B. Patient is stable. Surgeons have absolutely cleared, saying that there is no more spread of this infection and all the sinuses are clear. So once that signal is indicated, you could de-escalate to these two drugs, either of these two drugs, posaconazole or isavuconazole. But as I said, these formulations are even available as IV formulations. And this is reserved for patients who are not tolerating amphotericin B for any reason. Then IV posaconazole, the dosage is similar to oral, 300 mg twice a day on day one, followed by 300 mg once a day. You could give until you have control over the infection and then change over to tablet. And posaconazole, another distinct disadvantage is it cannot be given in patients who have AKI, and it is to be avoided if creatinine clearance is less than 50 ml per minute because there is accumulation of this toxic compound called bitadex sulfabutyl ether sodium when posaconazole is used in AKI patients. But the advantage of isavuconazole is it can be used even in patients with AKI because of less nephrotoxicity or no nephrotoxicity. So IV isavuconazole, the dosage is similar to oral, 200 mg 8th hourly for 2 days, followed by 200 mg once a day. So this dosages is something one possibly has to remember. So if there is a choice between posaconazole and isavuconazole, isavuconazole is non-nephrotoxic, and it is a newer kid on the block, newer drug. So one could choose based on the type of patient one would be dealing with. And as I said, it is safe in AKI. So another important aspect of mucor mycosis which came from this particular study is there should not be absolutely no delay in treatment. So as I said, this was a study, it was done in 70 patients. If there is a treatment delay of more than 6 days, so with treatment delay, we know with antibiotics, there is an exponential increase in mortality. It was found that mortality doubles when there is a delay in initiating of antifungal agents along with debridement. So 83% versus 49% was the mortality difference when there was a delay in the initiation of treatment. So the take-home message with regards to treatment is absolutely no delay in the surgical intervention, absolutely no delay in initiating antifungal. So as I said, if liposomal amphotericin B is not available, at least start off with amphotericin B at a dose of 1 mg per kg. If you are using liposomal, it is 5 to 10 mg per kg. 5 mg is what is recommended, but you can go up to 10 to gain good control if you are dealing with a raging sort of a mucor mycosis. So one would ask, what is there a good evidence for posaconazole or isavuconazole? For isavuconazole, there was this VITAL study where they looked at the median duration of treatment was 102 days. It was 33 days for patients with refractory mucor and 85 days for patients who were intolerant to amphotericin B. So they did a small study in 37 patients and they found day 42 mortality was 38%. At the end of treatment, the response rate was around 32% with isavuconazole. So this was another study where they used combination in 54 patients. The study came from US. So they used amphotericin B plus isavuconazole in some patients, in 21 patients, and they used amphotericin B as a monotherapy in 33 patients. They looked at day 42 mortality. As you see, it was not significantly different between combination and amfotericin B. Weighted all-cause mortality was 33% in combination as opposed to 41% in amfotericin B. So these are some of the studies of isavuconazole combination versus monotherapy. And friends, as you know, there is posaconazole, which is available as oral suspension. Don't get excited. So for Mucor, this oral suspension is not recommended as a de-escalatory therapy. If you are using posaconazole, it has to be used as tablets, 300 mg twice a day, followed by once a day. And you have to monitor serum concentration. I am completely unaware or unsure whether serum concentration of this posaconazole is done in our country. So that is something for you to keep in mind. But there is one study done with posaconazole oral suspension, which come from US in 91 patients. And they found there was a 60% sort of a response. But none of the society guidelines recommend the use of posaconazole oral suspension as a de-escalatory therapy for mucormycosis. So now the question which we answered, the duration of therapy is until the resolution of symptoms, which may take several weeks and even up to months. And the reversal of immunosuppression, which means if someone is on steroid, they should have come out. If underlying diabetes has to be well controlled, if there is an underlying leukemia or febrile neutropenia, all those have to be sort of should be in remission of some sort. And there should be good radiological resolution. So these are the stages. So when there is a clinical improvement, radiological resolution and reversal, then that is the time when you know that you can de-escalate to the oral and then maybe stop it after several weeks to months once you're absolutely sure that there is a good control over the disease. So now the question one would have is, amfotericin B may not be available in the market. So if IV posaconazole, then you have to resort to IV posaconazole or IV isavuconazole. What about echinocandins? So there is been a lot of debate whether echinocandins combining with amfotericin B would have a better merit in having good control over the disease. So there are three studies and they've shown not much difference by using combination with echinocandins because mucormycosis inherently would not respond to echinocandins. There is only one fungus called Rhizopus oryzae, which has an enzyme which makes it vulnerable to echinocandins. Otherwise, all other mucor are inherently resistant to echinocandins. So this was the study which came from US in 101 patients. So it was a retrospective. They looked at patients who got combination of amfotericin B and echinocandins in the year 1995 to 2003, only 5% got combination. And they compared with 31% of the patients who got this combination between 2004 to 2011. And they looked at 90-day survival, there was no difference. Basically saying that combination really didn't make a difference because although the combination therapy increased in 2004 to 11, but there was no difference in survival. So this was another study of 106 patients with invasive mucormycosis where one group had amfotericin B monotherapy and the other group had amfotericin B with echinocandins. They looked at 6 weeks mortality, there was no difference. So this study came in 2016 by US guys. So this was a study which was sort of positive, small study, 21 patients with rhino-orbital mucormycosis. So they had patients in monotherapy group. I think this number is wrong, must be 11. So, and then this is another group which had amfotericin B with echinocandins and the successful outcome was found to be 14 out of 31 in this monotherapy and all of them in this combination group improved. This was a small study which basically said the monotherapy was inferior to the combination therapy, but you can't make much out of it. So the limitations of this positive study, the authors say, it's very hard to determine whether benefit was more from good aggressive debridement surgery or whether it was antifungal. See, isn't it? Because although you may say combination may have worked, but it's very hard to attribute whether it is due to the antifungal agents or due to the good debridement that has happened. And echinocandins tends to be more effective in non-neutropenic. And all these patients in the study, the previous study where a combination showed to be beneficial was in non-neutropenic because echinocandins tend to have a modulatory function on the neutrophils. So they function better when there is no neutropenia is what is claimed by the author. So all in all, none of the society recommends combination therapy of amfotericin B with echinocandins for the treatment of mucormycosis. And neither does any recommendations of combining amphotericin B with posaconazole. So it has, the only drug of choice is liposomal amphotericin B. And if there is intolerance, then you can consider IV posaconazole or IV isavuconazole. And these drugs have to be used as a de-escalatory therapy in oral formulation once the clinical resolution, radiological resolution, and correction of the underlying thing has happened. So that is the essence of the whole treatment. So when we talk about outcome, now the question is, despite all this treatment, what is the risk of mortality? So as I said, when someone has a disseminated mucormycosis, mucormycosis which has spread in the blood, then the mortality is almost 96%. And as I said, the cunning hamela, so this is how the drug, this is how the mucor looks. So cunning hamela is found to be very virulent, and the mortality is found to be much higher in cunning hamela mucor. And as I said, if a patient with mucormycosis develops AKI, definitely that has a direct bearing on increasing the mortality. And in rhinoorbital mucormycosis, the risk factors for mortality, as I said, if there is a delay in initiating treatment, if it is there is a delay of more than 6 days, then there is twofold increase in mortality. Or if there is any neurological deficit, because once a neurological deficit is seen, it means that mucor has spread to the brain. So if there is a hemiplegia, diplopia, or bilateral sinus involvement or underlying leukemia, mortality is going to be very high. So the overall reported mortality in mucormycosis, predominantly rhinoorbital, is 25 to 62%. So that's the number for the listeners to just remember and bear in mind. So how about agents? So now we said the use, the presence of iron in the body increases the risk of dissemination of mucor because mucor feeds on the iron. So whether iron lowering agents would have any benefit in improving the outcomes with the mucor, so it is not recommended. So use of these iron reducing agents like deferoxirox is not recommended. There was one study which was published in 2012 by US in small group of patients where one group got amphotericin B with deferoxirox to reduce the iron and the other group with amphotericin. In fact, they found the 90-day death was more in the patients who got this deferoxirox. So this is not recommended. Any iron-lowering agent is not recommended in mucormycosis. How about hyperbaric oxygen therapy? So there are three case series which are reported, two from US, one from Israel. So small group, 13 patients, six got HBOT, and 7 on the control group, and the death was less in this. So you can't make concrete conclusions, but if you have a facility with HBOT therapy, and as HBOT therapy, you would know it is completely harmless, so there is no complication, there's no intervention. So you can put them in the HBOT chamber to have additional benefit in mucor. So having access to this HBOT may be a problem in many places. So if you have HBOT access, you could consider using this and then reporting whether it showed any benefit. So all in all, summary, so the mucormycosis is a dreaded disease which we are facing in the context of the COVID. So rhinoorbital is the more common mucormycosis followed by pulmonary mucormycosis. And the commonest sort of a risk factor in COVID would be use of steroids and underlying diabetes or underlying uncontrolled diabetes with acidosis. If there is a DKA, it increases the risk exponentially for mucor. So there is a lot of debate and concern whether use of contaminated water could be the cause. It could be the cause, but as I said, 47% of the patients who develop mucor in the hospital could be from the dirty linen, and mucor thrives in the moist sort of an environment. So water can be a source, linen can be a source, any soil can be a source, any of these can be a soil. So it is very imperative that the humidifiers that are being used have to be filled with a distilled water or a RO water. And this has to be changed every 24 hours to reduce the contamination in all the humidifiers. So this is very important to prevent the spread of mucor in our country. And as I said, the common ones that are found are mucor, rhizopus, and cunning hamela is another one. So this is succinia, and this is apophysomyces. And apophysomyces is found to be a much rarer variant of mucor. And the relation with iron, so if you're treating a patient with COVID, please avoid any iron infusion. Because as I said, presence of iron leads to this ferroxamine complex, and that facilitates iron uptake by the mucor, and the mucor really thrives on iron. So possibly iron acts as a sort of a agent which tends to increase the spread of this mucor. So that is something one needs to bear in mind. Please don't give iron supplements or iron injections for any of these patients you're treating with COVID. And diagnosis is always clinical and with histopathological examination of the tissue that you have debrided to confirm the presence of these filamentous hyphae in the examination. So treatment, I can't emphasize on this about the importance of debridement. And it is a treating mucor is not medical. It is a team effort. So it is very important that any physician treating mucor involves ENT surgeons, involves ophthalmologists, and a decision is made for an emergent sort of a debridement that should happen. And it's a staged debridement, and it is not like surgeons taking for debridement and it is done with. So multiple debridements have to be done to make sure there is absolutely no spread of this mucor, and the tissue is completely cleared of mucor. So repeated sort of a debridements and repeated sort of a surgical visualization has to be done to ensure that there is absolutely no fungus left in the sinuses or in the orbits. And along with this, it is very imperative that the antifungal agent should be started ASAP without absolute no delay, because any delay would exponentially increase the risk of dying. And the drug of choice is liposomal amphotericin B. And whilst you're doing all this, it is very important to treat the underlying risk factors. Like if someone is on steroids, stop the steroids, control the diabetes, control the acidosis, and any of the immunosuppressive agents are there underlying, so has to be at least relooked and stopped or rationalized. And once clinical improvement happens, radiological resolution happens. So this slide is a busy slide. It basically shows they can be de-escalated to posaconazole or isavuconazole. The dose is 300 mg twice a day, posaconazole followed by once a day. Isavuconazole is 200 mg 8th hourly for 2 days, followed by 200 mg once a day. If patient is intolerant to amphotericin B, then the recommendation is to consider IV posaconazole. Dose is similar, 300 mg IV twice a day, followed by once a day. And the IV isavuconazole also 200 mg 8th hourly for 2 days, followed by 200 mg once a day. And the advantage of isavuconazole is it is safe in AKI. Posaconazole you cannot give when there is an AKI or creatinine clearance less than 50. And the outcome, as I said, I'm not sure if any of the labs routinely do the speciation of mucor, because if there is a cunning hamela, then the virulence is more, so the risk of dying is more. And someone who develops AKI with mucor, the risk of mortality is much higher. So in rhino orbital, if there is any neurological deficits, the risk of mortality is very high. And mortality overall is in the range of 25% to 62%. So this is the cartoon, this is the image which is quite viral in our social media, and this is something which we should be worrying about, because so this is an individual who is covered with a cow dung, and people are proposing usage of cow dung to tackle this COVID, and this cow dung can be a very rich source of mucor, and we are not entirely sure if some of the mucors that is being reported across the nation is due to some sort of this practice of using cow dung. So it is very important to stick to the science and not be swayed by all this mythical and mystical sort of treatment modalities for COVID. So thank you very much. So I would end with this quote. So no matter how carefully you choose your words, they'll always end up being twisted by others. So thank you all. So if you wish to rehear to this lecture, you can visit my website, www.drpradeeplangappa.com, to rehear. Or you can visit my YouTube channel. So thank you all.